Again, welcome to Sundays at CTU. I'm Brian Murphy. I'm the Vice President for External Relations here at Catholic Theological Union. And on behalf of our President, Father Don Sr., and our Academic Dean, Sister Barbara Reed, our faculty, staff, administration, board, our students, all of our alumni, I welcome you to Sundays at CTU. We had a beautiful day here today. You know, thank God it wasn't yesterday.
Yes.
We all had a hard time coming down Lakeshore Drive, but we got a nice blanket of snow for this holiday season and nice holiday weather cooperating. A little bit about CTU for those of you who may not know about CTU. First of all, our mission is to prepare effective leaders for the church, ready to witness to the gospel's good news of justice, love, and peace. We prepare men and women, we prepare men for priesthood, and we prepare men and women for all kinds of different leadership opportunities within our church. We're the largest Roman Catholic graduate school of theology and ministry in the United States. We have students from all over the world that come here. If you came here on any given day, you'd run into students from dozens of different countries. It's just a wonderful experience. I say that because coming up in a few weeks is our J term, and registration is open. So if you're looking for potentially taking a class for enrichment, you could do that. Also, shortly on the heels of J term is our spring semester. Many students start then as well. If you know someone who would be considering graduate theological education, it's a great time to start as well. So we encourage you to do that. Also, as year end comes and you're considering your charitable contributions, we hope that you will consider CTU and as in your spectrum, because we know that you're all very generous. Sundays at CTU is a quarterly, roughly. It's a time when we get together, perhaps on the liturgical calendar, for instance today with Advent, for you to get an experience of CTU. You'll hear a lecture, there'll be a mass. It's an idea that we came up with a few years ago, and it's really achieved a lot of a good response from the community that we serve. I want to thank our host committee today, those that agreed to lend their name to today's Sundays and then encourage the rest of you to come. So thank you to you who are on the host committee for doing that. If you're interested in being on the host committee for a future Sundays at CTU, you can see me or Anne-Marie Turpak or Father Don or any of us that work here, and we'll gladly have you. It's not a lot of work. You give us your name, we send you some invitations, and you invite some others. Now a little bit about our speaker. Laurie Brink, Sister Laurie Brink, is a sister of the Cincinnati Dominicans. I'm partial to Cincinnatians. They raised me at St. Vincent Ferrer in River Forest. She has her PhD from the University of Chicago, and she is assistant professor of biblical studies here at CTU. Laurie investigates the ancient social and religious and cultural world out of which early Christianity emerged. Of particular interest is her, because I think she grew up in a military family, is the relationship of the military in the time of Christ. She's offered a number of books. One is In This Place, Reflections on the Land of the Gospels for the Liturgical Cycle. Many articles as well. She is a member of the American School of Oriental Research, the Catholic Biblical Association, the Chicago Society of Biblical Research, and the Society of Biblical Literature. Laurie is a very popular professor here at CTU. Her classes are always enthusiastic and energetic, and we're lucky to have her here, and we're all looking forward to her talk this afternoon. Laurie.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I've never liked Norman Rockwell. Not because of his artistic abilities, but because of his subject matter. Remember the scene of Thanksgiving dinner? Everyone sitting around the table, cheerful faces, waiting for Dad to carve the gigantic turkey. Where do these people live? Where's the kids' table? The rickety card table set up in another room for those under the age of, the bar changes every year. In the painting, everyone looks so happy to be together. Media portrayals like White Christmas and The Christmas Story present idealized familial scenes. Some of us here are old enough to remember the remarkable and unrealistic television families like the Cleavers, the Waltons, the Huxtables, or the Simpsons. Some of you are old enough to remember the Simpsons. Those that were either stylized representations of the perfect family or satirized portrayals of dysfunctional ones. This season of celebration is often wrought with a bit of angst, I think. We have very high expectations of ourselves and of the season. These days, our financial situations may limit our generosity. And we may be celebrating with family members we rarely see or hardly know. As we'll be reminded in our second reading today, harmony is something you have to work at. St. Paul writes to the Romans, "May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to think in harmony with one another, in keeping with Christ Jesus, that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another as Christ welcomed you for the glory of God." Endurance, encouragement, harmony, and welcome. Very good gifts to ask for this season. Not that I'm asking for any more gifts, because my Christmas came a bit early. See, I have two mothers. One that gave me birth, and one who raised me. For nearly half a century, I've loved the latter and longed for the former. And through a strange twist of fate, or more aptly, God's ever-present hand, 6 months ago, I met my mother, my biological mother. And so this Advent, as I reflect on the season anticipating the birth of Jesus, I am intimately aware of origins, my origins. I'm pondering anew questions like, what makes a family a family? Which has greater impact, biology or history? As a biblical scholar, I'm not so much interested in the sociological aspects as I am the theological ones. What makes the Joseph, Mary, and Jesus triad holy? What makes them family? And how does this holy family help me understand my own place within the various families to which I belong? Since we're entering liturgical cycle A, the infancy narrative found in the Gospel of Matthew is my starting point. The story begins with the genealogy of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And as the reader knows, the stepfather of Jesus. Why mention Joseph's lineage at all if Jesus is not his biological son? As the evangelist goes on to demonstrate, Joseph is very much the main character in his infancy narrative. In this day when hyphenations describe family relationships, step, foster, and half often do more to separate us than connect us. Perhaps by reflecting on Matthew's portrayal of Joseph, we can come to understand that what makes a family holy has less to do with the accident of biology and much more to do with the choice to love. This afternoon we'll start it with a discussion of the nativity story in Christian imagination. Then we'll focus on Matthew's unique contributions. And finally, we'll reflect on the concept of the good enough family, a term I borrow from my colleague Tony Gittins, who borrowed it from D.W. Winnicott. I hope by the end of our time together, we'll recognize that the good enough family, not the perfect family, is the holy family. The first bit of Christmas decorations my parents unpacked was always the nativity set. They had made it together in a ceramics class when they were newlyweds. My father had constructed a barn, often patched with items from my Lincoln Log set. Throughout the years, the donkey saw several repairs. Mary lost her hand, and the angel's wing was chipped. The kings fared better, and the shepherds were indestructible. Baby Jesus was safely glued into the manger, so he wasn't going anywhere. For my brother and me, and most children, our first understanding of the infancy narratives, the stories of Jesus' birth, comes from our family's creche set. Now, according to Bonaventure, St. Francis created the first creche, a living one, designed to instill in the people a greater sense of the solemnity of the festival. In a grotto overlooking the town, St. Francis brought in hay, a manger, ox, and a donkey. With the friars and people gathered, they began to celebrate liturgy. The custom grew in popularity and extravagance. Eventually, statues replaced the live actors. Well, in the excitement over Black Friday and Cyber Monday, if that's any indication, then St. Francis was right to be concerned that the celebration of Christ's birth has been a bit overshadowed by our commercialism. It's only when we have an opportunity to read the Gospel of Matthew or the Gospel of Luke that we begin to notice that we've got more characters around the Holy Family than either story depicts. In fact, our average creches demonstrate a popular conflation of both stories. And before we can focus on Matthew's portrayal of Joseph, let's untangle our popular nativity scenes. The infancy stories in Matthew and Luke share a few basic facts. Jesus was born in Bethlehem to Mary, a young woman engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. She becomes pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. All the events of Jesus' birth occur during the reign of Herod the Great, and angels factor into both stories. Now, here's a good time to mention a caveat. Hope it doesn't spoil the story for you. If you want to know the historical truth about the infancy narratives, you're going to be a little disappointed. We really can't verify the presence of magi from the east, or a star in the heavens, or even a manger. We are pretty sure about Bethlehem and Mary and Joseph. The point of the stories is not to present a detailed history, but rather to place the birth of Jesus in history. He is a real human being, born like other human beings, though his conception was unique. In Luke's Gospel, we hear the story from Mary's perspective. You remember, she encounters the angel Gabriel, who explains that she has found favor with God. She visits her kinswoman, Elizabeth, whom Gabriel has said is also expecting. Gabriel gives Mary the task of naming the baby Jesus, whereas Matthew places the responsibility with Joseph. Luke doesn't narrate how Joseph felt when he discovered his fiancée is pregnant. We do learn that they already live in Nazareth and have to travel to Bethlehem because of an imperial census. Alternately, Matthew's gospel sets Joseph as the main character. He is called a righteous man, and he is concerned about Mary's reputation when he discovers she's pregnant. He plans a quiet divorce until an angel appears to him in a dream and invites him to reconsider. In comparing the two stories, what appears most striking are the different witnesses. Matthew has magi from the east seek the new king of the Jews. The word magos originally referred to a member of the Persian priestly class. It later took on the connotations of those who engage in Eastern philosophy and science, hence magicians and astrologers. Matthew's magi report seeing a star rising, which in popular understanding signaled a significant birth. But this star is unusual. It directs the magi to Bethlehem, where they pay homage to baby Jesus, presenting him with gifts befitting a king: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And they're warned in a dream not to return the same way. Luke makes no mention of magi. In fact, the baby Jesus' first visitors are a rather scruffy lot: shepherds keeping watch over their sheep by night. Where the magi were guided by a star, the shepherds receive an angel of the Lord who announces the most amazing thing: I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Messiah and Lord. The angel gives directions to the baby, and suddenly a multitude of the heavenly hosts repeat the same thing: this is good news for all people. You can tell a lot about the authors of the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke by the audience they privilege with the first encounter of Jesus. For Luke, shepherds might have been reminiscent of biblical Israel, a wandering people. Or perhaps, as some social scientific scholars have suggested, the shepherds were those who stood outside the norms of cleanliness. They sleep outside, after all, with their sheep. These outcasts are the first to hear and respond. Luke's gospel will be filled with unlikely folks who hear, get it, and respond appropriately. The shepherds are just the first. Another obvious difference between the infancy narrative of Matthew and that of Luke is the location of the birth. Matthew has Jesus born in a house, oikia, which doesn't seem too significant for the gospel writer. In fact, we can presume from the text that Joseph and Mary are residing in their own home in Bethlehem. But Luke stresses that there's no place for Joseph and Mary where travelers normally stayed. So Jesus is born in a place with a manger. Luke is emphasizing Jesus' humble origins. But we could also imagine a first floor of a modest family home, where the animals reside below and the human family upstairs. Or, as is evident in Palestine today, a back room of a house is often carved into the soft rock of a hillside. In ancient times, folks kept their animals in the back as a source of heat. The manger, or feed box, separated where the human and animal residents belonged. Whatever Jesus' actual first accommodations, Matthew envisions his birth as inspiring notable travelers from the east to bring gifts fit for a king. Luke sees a contradiction: a baby who is Savior, Messiah, and Lord. Matthew and Luke, in their own way, recognize that Jesus' birth is for people of goodwill, all people of goodwill. Well, as the Christian imagination developed, people began to wonder, at what point did Jesus know he was the Son of God, or the Messiah? Was there something unique about his conception or birth? What was he like as a kid? Likely his family knew these stories, but they don't seem to be of much interest to the earliest communities. St. Paul gives no indication of concern or knowledge of the childhood of Jesus, or his earthly life, for that matter. And Mark begins his gospel with the ministry of John the Baptist and the adult Jesus. The infancy narratives may have arisen to combat derogatory rumors about Jesus' own parentage. The Gospel of Mark makes reference to Jesus as the son of Mary, which could be read as insulting to his mother, or simply that Mary is a widow. In the 3rd century, the early church father, Origen, cites Celsus, who charges that Mary was seduced by a Roman soldier. Origen refutes such claims, upholding the tradition of Jesus' miraculous conception. It's not without the possibility that the earliest infancy narratives about Jesus' conception by means of the Holy Spirit were meant to counter claims of his illegitimacy. There were probably multiple traditions of Jesus' early years. Remember, the Gospels aren't being written to some 40 years after Jesus' life. Stories were told orally and passed on to members of the community. In the mid-2nd century, the Proto-Evangelion of James was written and included much about the birth and life of Mary, introducing her parents as Anna and Joachim, and describing the midwives present at Jesus' birth. Probably contemporaneous with this proto-gospel of James, the infancy gospel of Thomas describes Jesus as a mischievous 5-year-old given to tantrums. Probably contemporaneous to the earlier one, they're describing in people's imagination what Jesus would have been like. Did he always know he was the Son of God? How'd that play out for a fully human child? These non-canonical gospels were a creative author's compilation of stories he or she had heard. Our own canonical gospels may have different stories reflected as their sources, but they're reflecting the emphasis each author has. Matthew has Jesus carried to Egypt to save him from Herod's slaughter of the innocents. Throughout the gospel, Matthew is making comparisons between Jesus and Moses. Both must be rescued from murderous rulers as infants. Some scholars see Matthew's use of a Moses typology evident in his restructuring of Jesus' teachings. Matthew organizes these into 5 blocks, perhaps meant to parallel the 5 books of the Torah, which were originally attributed to Moses. Where Matthew roots Jesus as the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies, Luke stresses Jesus' universal dimensions. Simeon recognizes the baby Jesus in the temple as the promised light to the Gentiles. We can surmise that these differences reflect concerns of the evangelist's original audiences. Traditionally, we've considered Matthew as writing for a Jewish Christian community, while Luke's community may have contained more Gentiles. Now, this idea of gospel communities has been recently challenged by some scholars who think that the evangelist really wrote for everyone, all Christians. I kind of think that the history of interpretation by the early church fathers on demonstrates that the gospels were clearly thought to speak to specific communities with specific needs. As we said earlier, the historical fact of Jesus' birth in Bethlehem, we think that's accurate. His parents were known to be Mary and Joseph of the house of David. What we have to keep in mind is that the evangelists are writing in the light of resurrection. They know who Jesus truly is. They write through the lens of Easter. So now let's turn our focus to Joseph. If we picture Matthew's infancy narrative, then we're presented with Mary, Joseph, and baby Jesus, the triad that will be known as the Holy Family. But as many gather in homes to celebrate this Christmas, our experience sometimes is a little less than holy. Okay, my experience, I don't know. I propose that reflecting on the character of Joseph might provide a renewed and more realistic example how to be a holy family at Christmas. Matthew's gospel opens with an odd encomium. Ancient rhetoric dictated the specific expectations for an encomium, or a work praising an individual. According to the ancient handbooks, the orator must first discuss the subject's background, personal attributes, rearing, and deeds. To present your subject in the best possible light, you must establish the quality of that one's forebears, since nobility and success were inheritances of a noble family history. If the subject happened to have an unsavory family history, then the orator had to show how, despite the difficulty, the subject had managed to pull himself up by his bootstraps, so to speak. It had to work with what he had. Discussion of a remarkable birth then followed. Certainly a person of noble ancestry who would go on to great success must have had an unusual birth. Portents must have been observed. Strange occurrences, evidence of divine favor. An orator would then list, either by direct statement or description, the qualities of the individual, including unique education, physical strengths, and remarkable deeds. But as we compare these elements of an encomium with the first two chapters of the Gospel, we recognize that Matthew has added his own twists to the standard rhetorical practices. Unless you think I'm misreading Matthew's intention, notice how he has carefully used a particular word to thread together his piece of praise. We hear in Matthew 1:1, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Clearly, the next subject addressed will be the ancestors of Jesus Christ. In chapter 1, verse 18, we then hear, now this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. Chapter 1, 18 to 25 will introduce a new subject, the genesis or origins of Jesus. The word we translate as genealogy and the word we translate as origins are both derived from the same Greek word, genesis. In the second section, we'll learn that despite the law, Joseph chooses to marry Mary, taking on the responsibility of her child and thus claiming the baby as his own. Chapter 2 also includes a variation of the same word, genesis. When Jesus was born, genethentos, in Bethlehem of Judea. The repetition of the word for origins, genealogy, genesis, and birth link Matthew's encomium. Here we will learn of Jesus' earliest experiences, the threats to his life, and the successful escape from the murderous hands of Herod. But interestingly, the reader's not told about the actions and deeds of Jesus, but those of Joseph. Case in point. The Gospel of Matthew begins not with the story of Jesus' birth, but with a genealogy listing all his ancestors and, in essence, Jesus' place in the history of Israel. Jesus is both son of David, who is designated as king, and son of Abraham. Jesus is also identified as Christ, or anointed. Luke will trace Jesus' ancestry back even further to Adam, the first human being. According to Matthew, Joseph's family tree is a bit odd. Unlike Luke, Matthew includes the presence of four women, three who are named, one who is not. The first is Tamar, who bears two sons to Judah, who had originally been her father-in-law. In a bit of trickery on Tamar's part, Judah mistook her for a prostitute, giving his seal and cord as a pledge for future payment. He had sex with her. Lo and behold, she conceived twin sons. When he heard his daughter-in-law was pregnant because she had prostituted herself, he sent for her in order to burn her. Imagine his surprise when she revealed his seal and cord. The next woman named is Rahab, who had hidden the Israelite spies when they reconnoitered Jericho. She's the mother of Solomon, the father of Boaz, the father of Obed, the father of Jesse, the father of David. This is the story of the ultimate other becoming the significant insider. Rahab, a prostitute, a foreigner, becomes a savior and mother of Israel. We remember the story of Ruth, the Moabite, who left her homeland to accompany her mother-in-law, Naomi. Ruth becomes the mother of Obed. And finally, the wife of Uriah is not named. But we know her name. It's Bathsheba, the mother of Solomon. While she's still married to Uriah the Hittite, David had relations with her. Foreigners, prostitutes, tricksters, and married women are included in Joseph's family tree. Scholars suggest that Matthew's inclusion of the four women may represent non-Jews and thus give his genealogy a more universal tone. I think Matthew recognizes that, as seen throughout the Old Testament, God often chooses the least likely as the instrument of divine action. Which reminds me of a story. Several years ago, speaking of genealogies, I was discussing with my grandmother our own family tree. I asked her if there were any noteworthy people among our ancestors. Bishops, dukes, famous women. It helps if you know who my grandmother was. She responded emphatically, and I'll take out the expletives. Oh no, our relatives were all heretics and horse thieves. I take comfort in Matthew's genealogy. Matthew's detailed listing of ancestors not only includes infamous women, but some irascible men as well. Not all kings of Judah were well thought of. You need only read 2 Kings 21 to hear the terrible deeds done by Manasseh, father of Amos, father of Josiah. It's not only who's who that's interesting, but also how Matthew has structured the listing. Matthew shapes his genealogy in generations of 14, related to significant events in Israel's history, from Abraham, the first to respond to God, to David. The reader recognizes that this first division runs from the time of the promise to the establishment of the kingdom. Next, we have Solomon to the deportation to Babylon. During this time, the kingdom is divided and eventually destroyed. The last time period moves the ancestors of Joseph from exile to a return to the land. The final name in the genealogy is Jesus, who is called Christ, whom we see as the culmination of God's promise begun in Abraham. Odd characters in a family tree, difficult episodes in a family history, loss and deprivation, and return. Matthew's encomium includes both praise and disgrace. In the second section, in which Matthew discusses beginnings, it is Joseph himself and not his ancestors that's now the focus. We hear now this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. When his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found with child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her to shame, decided to divorce her quietly. Matthew describes Joseph as a just or righteous man, dikaios in the Greek. The same word is used to describe Noah, Abram, and David. The concept of the righteous one has a long biblical pedigree. In essence, to be righteous is to be just and holy before God, the ultimate example of righteousness. So Joseph exhibits the same qualities as his noteworthy ancestors. Joseph chose not to shame Mary, and so to divorce her quietly. At this point in the story, Joseph has the first of four dreams in which an angel appears to him. The angel of the Lord tells Joseph, "Don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, since that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit." The angel then directs Joseph to name the child. Finally, a biblical warrant is given for the amazing event. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. Matthew's understanding of who Jesus is, his Christology, is evident in the naming of the baby.
The angel tells Joseph to call him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. The name Jesus is derived from the Hebrew word Yahushua, meaning the Lord is salvation, which is a longer version of Joshua. The baby will fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah. This Jesus will also be known as Emmanuel, God with us. So in Matthew's account of the naming of the baby, Jesus is both God's salvation and God incarnate. The angel will reappear to direct Joseph to Egypt and to tell him when to return. And finally, Joseph is directed in a dream not to go to Bethlehem, but to travel to Galilee. But to read the story as if Joseph is simply and obediently responding to the angel's direction is to overlook the building tension of each scene. Joseph makes choices, weighs his options, and reconsiders. Joseph and Mary's beginnings as a couple are no storybook wedding. The Holy Family includes, in today's terms, a mother, a child, and a stepfather. Hardly the image Francis had in mind setting up his first crush. What role is Joseph playing? What is Matthew showing us? I propose that Matthew is introducing Jesus by way of the characterization of Joseph, a type of foreshadowing through character formation. We know that Jesus is not the natural son of Joseph, but perhaps we are meant to recognize that it isn't solely biology that shapes one's personality. Even divine biology. The nature versus nurture question becomes not an either or, but a both and. Joseph is portrayed as an Israelite with a mixed history, righteous, reflective, faithful, and noble, all attributes that will later be ascribed to Jesus. At the end of chapter 2, the encomium to Joseph comes to a close. He will not be mentioned again in Matthew's gospel. In chapter 3, the now adult Jesus is introduced. Jesus travels from Galilee to the Jordan in order to be baptized by John, who at first declines. And we hear, "I need to be baptized by you, yet you are coming to me." Jesus said to him in reply, "Allow it now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." As did Joseph before him, Jesus is now following the way of righteousness. And a voice from heaven calls out, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We traditionally understand this as God's acknowledgement of paternity. But we could also imagine a stepfather Joseph echoing similar words. Joseph demonstrates for us that parenthood isn't solely determined by biology. He's not the biological father of Jesus. Nonetheless, he chooses to become the legal father of Jesus when he takes Mary into his house and subsequently names the child. By so doing, Jesus becomes Joseph's son and a son of David. This idea of adoption isn't a new one. Remember Moses? He was adopted into the family of Pharaoh in Exodus 2:10. And the prophets tell of God's love for Israel as a parent for a child. In the New Testament, St. Paul uses the metaphor of adoption to explain to believers their relationship to God. In Romans 8:15, we hear, "For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption through which we cry, Abba, Father." Families in the ancient world included biological and adopted members, slaves and freed people, and an assortment of relatives. What most often united these seemingly different members was their worship of the family god or gods. Not so today. What comprises a family is a hotly debated topic. According to the Census Bureau's definition, a family is a group of two people or more, one of whom is the householder, related by birth, marriage, or adoption, and residing together.
the Census Bureau. What the book counted out, same-sex relations and the Americans' definitions of family, by Brian Powell, a sociology professor in Indiana, suggests that many Americans are broadening their definitions of what does or doesn't constitute a family. The majority still see the presence of children in the household as the deciding factor. And more folks are recognizing that same-sex couples with children meet the definition. But as is all too obvious, not all families include two parents. The high rate of divorce is having consequences on the next generation. Several websites address the appropriate etiquette at weddings when the bride and or groom's parents are divorced and remarried. Whose names are on the invitation? Who sits where? Who walks the bride down the aisle? Have become increasingly difficult questions to answer as family structures become more complex. And some families don't fit any definitions. A wonderful case in point is found in an article by my colleague Tony Gittins, In Search of Good Enough Families, Cultural and Religious Perspectives. Yes, I stole the title from his book. It's found in the book Mutuality Matters, Family, Faith, and Just Love. Tony writes, there is a variety of evolving family forms and myriad existential families that are untypical or unique. Is it possible that, though they are neither perfect nor complacent, but struggling and surviving, these blended families may be the repositories of some critical family values, and in fact be good enough? The term comes from the psychologist D.W. Winnicott, who used the phrase good enough mother to describe the parenting functions that provide sufficiently to meet the needs of the child. By comparison, the good enough family is that unit that is able to sustain and promote the well-being of its members. Not perfectly, but sufficiently. In a footnote, Tony explains that his own good enough family consists of his adopted adult daughter, three adopted children, her one biological child, her common-law husband, and the adopted mother of his daughter, who is not related by marriage or blood to Tony. Did I forget to mention that Tony's a priest in good standing in his religious community? And the daughter's adopted mother is a religious sister. Unlike most familial arrangements, this unique one was initiated by the adult daughter, who recognized that she needed parents who could help her negotiate her very complicated and difficult life. This arrangement might not resemble the traditional definition, but as Tony writes, it is a good enough family in the sense that it struggles in an explicitly Christian fashion to address the needs of each of its members and to act justly in the wider world. In a way, the infancy narratives of both Luke and Matthew describe a good enough family. The would-be parents are both invited to choose their roles. They have the freedom to decline the divine offer. But as we know in Luke's gospel, Mary responds with her Magnificat. Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word. In Matthew's infancy narrative, the story is told from Joseph's perspective. He may not be the biological father of the baby, but the angel invites him to be the good enough father, symbolized by his naming of the child. As we gather with our own renditions of the good enough family, may we recognize that Jesus, Emmanuel, the son of David, who we know as the Christ, was born of a virgin, betrothed to a man who chose to be his father. As Mary and Joseph demonstrate, both biology and relationship make the good enough family into the holy family. But what makes the holy family holy? Some might say it's the presence of the divine child, Jesus. But I think holy is also an attribute of Mary and of Joseph. Both are given the opportunity to be conduits of divine action and divine love. Though using differing sources, Luke and Matthew paint a remarkably similar portrait of God's invitation to Mary and to Joseph, in which both are given a choice to become an unconventional, good enough family. God holds out the same invitation to us. Are we willing to accept that our own good enough family is also a holy family?